I think there's a special relationship between the rock and the people and the security. In the formation days of Flin Flon, there was a large European influence. It was pretty troubled over in Europe. The First World War had just ended, and there was a large influx of people that came seeking gold from Hungary and Yugoslavia, Czechoslovakia, Germany, France, Scotland, England, Ireland, every nation. They came to make a fortune, and they stayed to build a community. And the Hudson Bay Mining and Smelting Company has been an extremely stable company. And I think as long as the people see the rock and they see that stack, there's a feeling of security.
Welcome to Underground. Currently, we're standing on the 390-foot level of Hudson Bay Mining and Smelting's Flin Flon North Main Mine. Behind me, we have one of the chutes located on one of the oldest levels of our mines, the 390-foot level. This level was basically driven to accommodate ore movement from the bottom of our open pit mine in the late 20s and produced up until the 60s. Mining has changed in the last 70 years. Nowadays, our drifts are considerably larger than this. We don't have the timber, and the amount of ore that we can move in one day is substantially increased. So the tunnel, or what we call the drift that we're currently standing in, was developed back in those days to the dimensions of 8 feet high and between 9 and 10 feet high. Currently, our drifts at our newer mines, say like Trout Lake or Namu, could be anywhere from 15 to 20 feet high by 17 to 24 feet wide, depends upon the equipment that will be running in the operation. This mine was actually accessed through a shaft or a glorified elevator, as some people like to call it. What we see currently on the wall, the green and the white, is an action of the water coming through the ore body. As it passes through the ore, it acts as a leaching agent and picks up some of the copper. And as it accesses to the air, or gets exposed to the air, it drops and deposits the copper on the wall and gives us the green color, or what we call copper sulfite. The reason there's so much splashing and water that we are currently seeing and experiencing is because we are in one of the oldest levels of our North Main mine, and we no longer work in this area, so the water just basically seeps in and we just let it run where it happens to end up. Our newer mines are a lot drier and a lot better lit. Our operations in this area have been running since the mid-20s, when we started with the open pit. Up until the end of 1988, we had produced roughly 70 million tons of ore, with 13 mines having come and gone. Currently, we have 3 mines in operation, and our ore potential for the future is looking exceptionally well with our Trout Lake operation. So we will probably be here for a little while longer.
To be a prospector, a fella has to, first of all, be in real good health. And from a personality viewpoint, he has to be very, very optimistic as hell, because there's very few prospectors that are on wages. They're just living off the land or trapping. The first find was found in 1915, which is the Mandy mine just down the lake here. And my dad came up in the early 1920s after the First World War. And each summer my dad used to have us come up, my brother and I come up in the summertime, and we'd put more pits in at Snow Lake and Blast, and more pits out at Beaver Lake. And that went on through the 30s. We used to more or less live off the land, you know. And we'd take salt and pepper and sugar and the essentials into the bush, but we'd shoot a moose and smoke them, hang it up in the tree, and when we wanted a steak, we'd bring it down and catch fish and rabbits. In those days, it was mostly panning and actually chipping samples off of quartz veins and sending them out for assay. But panning was a very essential tool in those days, and that's the way my dad found the Snow Lake deposit in the Arachne mine. Well, once you start prospecting, you'll always be a prospector.
I think a lot of people come because we're resource-based, and one of our greatest resources, in addition to the minerals, is fishing. And we a lot of visitors. A lot of visitors, too, come for strictly the scenic, rugged beauty of the North. It's sort of last of the tame wilderness. People get a sense of being in the wilderness, and yet there's security, there's nothing to fear. Locking doors is something that people in Flin Flon really aren't accustomed to. Flin Flon is a city built on rock. It's an easy place to find and a hard place to leave.
For more information about Manitoba's North of 53 region and Flin Flon, you can call toll-free 1-800-665-0040, extension 325.